Thank you. So a Beethoven recital, very special anniversary, and of all the composers that you can give a single evening to, Beethoven is one of the best, because he's one of the most human composers. He was someone who knew how to struggle, and composing for him wasn't easy, whereas someone like Mozart could pretty much sketch everything out in his head and then just write it down. Beethoven really, really had to think and struggle and persevere, and I think that those are qualities that strike us here at Repton in normal times, but especially in these times now. And we hear this in most of the music that he composed. But what I've done is chosen a program that has some music from each of the three periods of his life, the early period, the middle period, and the later period. So in this first half, which is slightly longer than the second, we have something from the early period, middle, and late. And then the second half has the big appassionata sonata, which is the most exciting and tempestuous pieces ever written for piano. And so first of all, the other thing is that, of course, the each of the pieces has something which is unique to Beethoven. He was someone who really stretched the boundaries of music and form and how the instrument was used, and each of these pieces shows you a little of that, some facet of his work. So the first piece, it's right at the end of his early period, written at the turn of the 1801, and it's a sonata, but it's also called Sonata Quasi Fantasia. So it's like a fantasia. He was one of the first composers to write one sonata, which actually all the movements merged into one. So it's effectively one 15-minute sonata without a break. But within that, you've got four sections. So the first one is very gentle and very, very pastoral in character, and then that's interjected with a sudden fiery moment, which was very characteristic of Beethoven. Apparently, he had a very fiery temper, and you hear that in the a little interjection in the middle of that sort of first movement. And then the calm returns. The second movement is like a scherzo, and it's got driven rhythms, and it sounds like it's a middle section. It sounds like you've got horses galloping in the middle, and then that theme returns. Then it turns into a very calm, beautiful melody. Beethoven loved the countryside, and that's where he got all his inspiration from. Looking at the lakes and the trees, and he'd have a notebook and he'd be jotting down ideas. And I think you can hear that in that third movement, just a beautiful, beautiful melody, and gorgeously harmonised as well. And then the last movement, which goes follows straight on, is it's a presto. It's a very exciting. It's just like going for a run. And in this case, the fingers are going for a run, and it's very lots of driven rhythm, very clean lines, and that's a feature of his early style. It's all very clean and tidy. But Beethoven being Beethoven, there's a few moments of anger and aggression coming through, which you perhaps don't hear in some of the composers a little earlier. So here it is, the Sonata Quasi Fantasia.
Thank you.
Someone, if it would give him a theme, a very short theme, and they'd say, right, there's your theme, now, what can you do with that? And he would improvise and create a piece on the spot based on that particular theme. And I think this set of variations, it's a very short theme, and then you get 32 variations based on this. And I think it gives us just a little idea, just of what his improvisation skills must have been like. And contemporary reports show that he could be really quiet and very almost spiritual in effect, and then other times he could be really wild and angry and using all of the keyboard and creating a real fiery presence. And I think you hear that in these. Now, those of you who are really good at maths will be able to count your way through the 32 variations. Some of them run into each other naturally, and others there's a little pause where musically natural to do it. So here they are, Beethoven's 32 variations, as pretty much from his middle period, dating around 1805, 1806.
Thank you.
So I hope you see what I mean about this feeling of in fact, he was probably, certainly in musical terms, sort of the original angry young man. He Beethoven knew his own worth, and he knew what he wanted to do, and he knew where he wanted to go, but sometimes the paths of opportunity didn't always open up for him in the way he wanted to. And so, although I'm missing out a little bit of the middle section now, which I'm leaving until after the interval, we have a little skip forward now to his later style. After all the struggle and the tempestuous nature of some of the music, then this late style is very, very, it is a feeling of soul searching and a feeling of reaching for almost for the unreachable, technically and spiritually as well. And you hear that in the first movement of the A-flat sonata, the penultimate sonata he wrote, which again the opening is it's ethereal and so beautiful in sort of melodic and harmonic content, and the effect is really quite special. The second movement is in normal sonatas, the classical period, you normally get a fast movement, then you get a slow movement, maybe a minuet and trio, and then a faster movement to finish. But Beethoven altered the order of everything. So the second movement of this is a scherzo, and you hear that some of the harmonies here are just a little bit dissonant, and it's quite an aggressive movement, and the middle section it's like a bolt from another world. And you think, well, how does that relate to the first sonata we heard tonight? It's almost unrecognizable. And Beethoven is reaching again for something that almost is unobtainable. Something amazing happens in that Beethoven was a devotee of the music of George Frederick Handel. And I know it's probably an apocryphal tale, but it was said that on his deathbed, shortly before he was legalized, he'd been given a complete set of Handel's works, and they were piled up in the corner of the room. And it is said, it's thought that one of his last words, or some of his last words, where he pointed to the scores and said, "There lies the truth." And so the music of Handel did influence him, and it does in this sonata too, because all of a sudden, from that rather forward-looking scherzo, we get a recitative, which you normally find in oratorios and operas and so on. And of course, Handel in this great Messiah, where you have a recitative, which is like a little introduction, and takes us into an aria. And sure enough, Beethoven produces an aria, and then he follows that with a fugue, which is another Baroque practice, where we have a theme and it's repeated in a higher part and a lower part and so on, and then it's almost as Beethoven is still searching for the truth, and then he breaks out from the fugue into a second aria, which is based on the first one, and then we get a final fugue, which this time, instead of starting low and working up, he starts high and inverts it and comes down again. So it's a different pattern. It's a different mathematical structure, and then eventually it catches fire and it ends in triumph. I think it was Daniel Barenboim who said that if he had to sum up Beethoven, in essence, it's triumph over adversity. And I think we hear that in the sonata. It's all the soul searching, it's all the struggle, it's all the different paths you take, and then eventually we find our way back and we end in a triumphant A-flat major. So this is probably the most challenging piece to listen to, but if you think of it in those terms, it's so human. This is a chap who's struggling. If you saw the manuscript, it's full of scribblings out, changes, ripped pages, ink stains, coffee stains, everything. You can feel him struggling to get these notes down. And listening in that context, hopefully, will help you to understand a little bit of what Beethoven went through to get there.
Thank you. Thank you.
Perhaps just a little bit too extended for that, and as it was one of his personal favourites, therefore it's picked up the title Andante Favori. It's a rondo, which basically means you have the first theme, and then there's an episode, and you get the main theme back, an episode, and so on. So it's an A, B, A, C sort of structure. But Beethoven just varies the main theme each time it comes back. You know, lesser composers would just put the same theme down every time, but Beethoven always makes a few subtle changes. There's either a change to the left-hand accompaniment, or there's an added harmony, and that's what we get. So it's a gentle piece, but it's a bit of a palate cleanser, if you like, for what's going to follow in the Appassionata sonata. So here it comes, Andante Fabri.
Thank you.
major to F minor, which is what the whole cycle has been really building up to now. So the Appassionata Sonata, chord because it is, as the title suggests, one of the most passionate outbursts of musical creativity probably ever created for anything, let alone a piano. You may have heard or read that Beethoven was one of the first composers to write how you term orchestrally for the piano. It's as though he imagined the sound of the full symphony orchestra when he played. And you can have some idea of how Beethoven must have played himself, considering in his early years before the deafness took hold. He was known as one of the virtuosos of the time, particularly in Vienna. But anyway, the feature of this. And as the deafness did take hold, of course, there was major frustration, and Beethoven was known for there were so many disappointments in his life. All the things that people take for granted, wanted to settle down, have a family, all these kinds of things, it wasn't possible for him, and he felt increasingly shut away because of his deafness, and feeling that perhaps his career hadn't developed in the way he wanted to. And at one stage, he actually wrote what was effectively an open testament, almost like an open will. He went to Heiligenstadt and wrote what is now known as the Heiligenstadt Testament. And in it, to paraphrase, he actually says that he only wishes that he could have one day of true happiness, just one day, just to be able to experience that without the, you know. And when he grew up, an alcoholic father, his mother passed away when he was very, very young, and all of these things, he had to look after the family. He felt this sense of purpose. And also the other thing which he wrote was the fact that were it not for his musical gifts and felt that it was God-given talent, that he would probably have not wanted to continue, but somehow he felt his duty was to fight on. And I think we hear this fighting spirit and this never say die attitude more than anything, or more than ever, in this sonata, the Appassionata Sonata. So it's a case of, it starts very brooding at the opening, very quiet, and then also these sudden outbursts of anger, frustration, and passion. And you hear this throughout the whole of the movement. It drives and drives and drives and drives, and it's almost unbearable. And the second movement, by contrast, is a lyrical set of short variations, just calm. It's almost as if he's found inner peace. And then, just as we're getting to the end of the movement, you think, it's going to be a perfect ending. But no, we get a diminished chord, and you think, there's something that the storm clouds are brewing again. And sure enough, he goes into a fiery final movement, which is in sonata form, builds and builds and builds. And just as you think it couldn't build any further, then there's a final surprise at the end. So it's one of the most exciting pieces, and daunting to listen to and to play. It's not a soul-searching a piece like you heard with the Opus 110 just before the interval. This is just a case of just letting his feelings come to the fore, letting all the frustrations out. It's no holds barred. It's Beethoven's Appassionata Sonata.
Thank you.
quite a journey, and I hope it just gives you an idea of Beethoven's output and the whole scope of his work, and also why perhaps Beethoven is perhaps one of the only composers that can play anywhere to anyone, any part of the planet, and they will say, ah yes, that's Beethoven. And it's taken to war-torn countries or on the borderlines of countries that are in conflict. Daniel Barenboim took his Westminster Divan Orchestra to give concert Beethoven symphonies on the Korean border, South and North Korean border, and for those moments, while the symphony played, there was silence, there was rapt attention, there was peace on earth. And may that be a message to us all. So thanks so much for listening, and let's hope it was a really good tribute to Beethoven from us all. So thank you and good night.